Thank you. Welcome. You all had a pleasant flight? Still a little bit jet lagged. The first thing I always do when I start a seminar is apologize. Very simple, my native tongue is not English, but it's Dutch, meaning that if I say anything during the seminar that will offend you, it probably will happen for some people, it was not meant that way. If you think that was really funny, then it was absolutely meant that way. So keep it that way. So what do I do? The last time I was here, I did something that I normally actually don't really do as a profession, and that was street photography. And I love street photography. But my real profession, of course, is fashion. And not really fashion, we shoot models, we shoot fashion, hair, celebrities, that kind of stuff. But most of all, what I really like is teaching. That's actually where my passion actually is. Because teaching is something that I think you have to be born with it, to inspire people, to hear from people like, okay, you show me something and it really changed my life. And that's the best feeling ever. You can shoot whoever you want and you get the most beautiful images, but if somebody comes up to you and say, man, that really changed the way that I look at my photography, that's the best kick ever. And recently in November, I released a book called Mastering the Model Shoot. And if you don't have the book, check it out. I think it's pretty cool. Okay, so this is my website, and the seminar from today is from OK to Wow. Now, what I see a lot of photographers doing is great. They have great images, they have great backgrounds, they have great models, they have semi-great poses or great poses, and there's always something missing. You know that feeling? You look at your images and you go like, awesome, but. And I hope today that but I can take away. So let's see what we can do. The first thing is, what is photography for me? For me, photography is very, very simple. It's we as photographers are actually freezing moments in time that will never, ever come back again. We freeze something that's unique. You have to think about that. There are a lot of photographers out there shooting on what I always call the monster race. They just put on the camera and they go like, and I go like, dude, really, do you want to see the model breathe? It's like, don't do it like that. Just choose that one moment, because it's all in 1/1000th of a second. That's the moment, a unique moment in time that will never ever come back. If you mess it up, that's it. So what is it for me? Like, this is way, way out of my comfort zone. This is a very famous in the Netherlands piano player called Wiebe Suryadi. He also played Carnegie Hall, I believe, here. And he's like this really celebrity. He has his own TV show, and he's a personal friend of us over the years. And he asked me, can you shoot me in the concert hall, Amsterdam Concert Hall? One of the problems with the Amsterdam, and it's called Concertgebouw, is that you actually can't shoot, unless you're me, because I was asked by the artist. I've been kicked out sometimes, and then always his manager comes in, Frank can go. And so what is that little thing extra? Like if you see this, this is a classical piano player. What do? They normally sit down. They relax for like a minute and they start playing. Of course, you can take a picture while he's playing, right? But sometimes, and I know that, he will just stop, put up his hands, and just freeze for a fraction of a second. And that's the point that I wanted, because this is not classical. And this is something that tells a story. But as you can see here, this is a very boring point of view, right? It's on top, it's aimed down. Okay, you see the whole building and you see him. But is it interesting? No way. So go a little bit closer, get nice rim lights, beautiful, much better, right? Go closer. But it's not about him all the time. It's also about what happens during his concert. People listening find the second story inside a concert. Now, this is very close up to the podium. This is illegal. You can't go up like this if he's there and go like, great. I would have taken that note a little bit different, but we accept it. It's a still, you know? He's really good, by the way. So this is close, but is that enough for me? This is a shot that actually nobody can take because it's not allowed. But is it enough? No, it's never enough. You always want to go further. So what do? You go on stage. And you see people going like, what? He's crazy. He will be kicked off. And I'm just sitting there, and he's coming over, hi Frank, sitting down, and he's playing. I'm literally this far away from him, and shooting. And the fun part is, he's a little bit smaller than me, so when I use a wide angle, I can actually also make sure that he gets his applause nice. The fun part is, if you see images like this, one thing you do is you get something unique, and you get something with power and passion. Find that right moment, and a lot of people go like, "Doof, awesome, got it," and they stop. You know that feeling when you hit a shot and you think, this is it? Trust me, when I think this is it, there will always be one or two that are better. But don't shoot until, you know, the model drops dead because he's tired and you drop dead. I've heard shoots that go on from 10 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night. That's just wrong. Our shoots are actually from 10 in the morning till approximately 12, 1. And then we're on our peak of our energy and then we stop. And people go like, why don't you go on longer? I want my model on the peak of her energy. As soon as he starts fading, the images aren't good anymore. So let's see, our language is light. And this is how a lot of photographers talk. They look at each other and they go like, huh? Yeah, I want that light over there on f2.8 because I want an incident meter reading from the back and make sure that it's totally wide. So overblown it by 3 stops, incident, or reflective. Oh, I don't know. Incident or reflective, what's the difference? I don't know, just do it. I read it in Frank's book. Actually, when you are a photographer, everything you do is with light. Light is our language. Learn that language. Learn lighting, one of the most important things. Everybody who comes to me and they say, Frank, I just started photography. How can I be a pro? Earn money. They go like, yeah, but how do I earn money? Make great images. Yeah, but I've tried so hard, Frank, and I can't make great images. What can I do? Okay, how long are you shooting? Well, I think a long time. Let me see. Let me calculate back. It's now February, and I got my camera a little bit before Christmas. But man, if it doesn't happen overnight, I'm going to quit. Quit. One of the things, and I once wrote a guest book for Scott Kelby about it, The Hunting Photographer. Don't hunt for it. If you love what you do, if you have passion for what you do, people will find you. As soon as you start setting goals, okay, tomorrow I want to shoot Lady Gaga. It doesn't happen. So we stop. We don't do photography anymore, right? Because we didn't reach our goals. Don't set goals. Set one goal. Improve every day by learning, by doing something. Learn your language. And then on the set, it won't look like this, but it will look like, okay, I want that background to be white. Okay, I will meet a reflective 3 stops over. Thank you. That's nice. Yeah, do you want your rim lights also 1 stop higher? Yeah, please. There you go, Frank. And you go like, wow. But this is actually how it should be. None of my assistants ever, and they come from photo academies, 4th-year graduate, professional photography, give them a light meter and they go like, what's that? It's a light meter. Meter light. I saw one in a book once. Who wrote it? Okay, our language is light. If your images aren't interesting after that, stand in front of something that's interesting. This is a quote from somebody else, by the way. But I've heard it from so many angles that I don't know who it is. But it's not my quote. Stand in front of something interesting. Now, what is very interesting? Something like this. An airplane and a model. But it's not only that. Ah, that's Dutch. Zoek de juiste hoek. Find the right angle. So how do you do something like that? Well, this is Cirque du Soleil. I did this during a pre-con with Joe McNally. And they set everything up for shots like this. Awesome, right? You have this beautiful girl on, how do you call this? Curtains or something. And they do this amazing stuff and it's cool. And I took the shot and I was going like, you know, it's a black background, it's nice rim lights, it's nicely lit. And I just looked at Joe, I said, can I do something else? And he said, what do you want to do? And there were like 20, 30 people shooting from exactly the same position. I always call that the Kodak point. If somebody shows you, shoot it from here, all the students will go like, okay.
Wow. Wow.
But they get the same images. So what I did actually was I lay on the floor. And a shot like this. The first thing somebody said to me, don't you find that now that the black background is gone that you get all this mess in the picture? I said, yeah, I love it. Look at the leading lines. Look at how C's totally different now. Do you see that? But also the lights are totally different. You get a nice lens flare from here, slightly enhanced in Photoshop. It's just a totally different image. It's unique. The fun part was, as soon as I did it, everybody. But okay. Now expression. This is something that I miss in a lot of shoots. You see models standing like this. And I'm not a model, by the way. And the photographer is going like doof, doof, doof. Go like, yeah. And that's because the photographers don't talk. You know that problem? Be a talker. Talk to your models constantly. A lot of photographers go like this. And the model is just standing there and going like, wow. When I take a photo, I always go like, cool, great, go, nice, fine, okay, awesome, do the other thing. Yeah, that was awesome. Do the other thing that was awesome before that awesome thing. It doesn't matter what you say, as long as you keep talking with the model. I never say, oh, that sucked. No, don't do that, you look fat. Uh-oh, no, the light is hitting you totally wrong. You see all your scars and your... Did you know that your eye is totally awkward in this position? Don't do it like that, because the model will go like, oh, really? Don't. So expression can be very subtle. And from subtle, we go to a little bit more extreme. This is actually one of my students. I said, okay, stand in front of the camera, look surprised. I said, okay, that's cool. Can be very, very intense. Also nice. Or very, very vintage. It can be very dark, just looking through a veil. It can be very expressionist. This actually was a shot. This is an old mirror we had in our store, which you could actually see over the whole store. So somebody came in and you saw the reflection of the people coming in. And it was all dusty. And my assistant actually said, should I clean it up before you take the shot? I said, are you nuts? Keep it that way, nice and dirty. And this was actually a challenge from a student of mine. She said, you know, we did a one-on-one workshop with her. And she said, everything that you normally set up must be something that you have in your head or done before. I said, one of the most important things as a photographer is if you do something and it's very successful, try to not do it again. Try to do something new. Yeah? Try to do something new again. Try to build on that successfulness. So in this case, I said, okay, I've never done this before. Stand up, lean down, scream. We had one strobe here. I was laying on the floor and it just shot straight into the strobe. She saw the image. She said, didn't you do that before? No. Then why did you know it worked? And I can explain you why I know that it worked. For the very simple reason. I mirrored on my model towards the strobes. I knew my exposure was right. I chose a very low angle. I can see through my viewfinder that my composition is right, right? It's not that you see an awesome composition, you shoot and you see a landscape. No, what you see through the viewfinder is what you get. And I know that if I shoot from this angle, I get this really nice, almost surreal look. Let your model scream, success. So don't think about it, just do it. It has to be second nature. A lot of my models scream somehow, I don't know. Sometimes they also look very bad, very angry. Or more open. Black and white. Vintage. And you see that all the expressions, although very subtle, are there. It's no emptiness. This was, believe it or not, it's on a boat from Emmeloord, I wanted to say now. From Hoek van Holland to England. We did a workshop tour in England and we brought a model. So what do you do when you're on a boat and you're feeling nauseous? You just take your camera, you go out, and a lot of people look at this image and they go like, man, I love the styling, the aggression of the model, I love the location. And I was going like, you know how I took this shot? I was going like, oh, that looks pretty interesting. Okay, look up, thank you. And I went in. We only took like 6 or 7 shots. And it's okay, you know, because we were outside, we were having fun. And one of the shots I actually uploaded, I think it was this one or another one, and people were going berserk, like, this is one of your best shots ever. And I was going like, I should be nauseous all the time when I shoot. But it's so simple. And then when I looked at the image, I know why. Look at the pose. That little cigarette, and I hate smoking, but that little cigarette just did it. And that's that small part. It's pure coincidence. My model smoked, she was smoking. I said, okay, look all the way up, boom, take the shot, make it harsh, black and white, and you're there. Nothing with strobes, nothing with lights, just a standard camera, standard lens, done. Expression, telling a story, going overboard. But most of all, how do we get the lights to burn? I love to put in little tips between the seminar. A lot of people said, how did you get the lights to burn? Are there strobes in there? And I go like, no. Did you Photoshop it in? I wish. Do you have powerless power? I said, yeah. Imagine this, walking through our studio, go like, oh, stop, dude, please. Why? You almost hit the wireless power. Oh, thank you. And going, no, of course we don't have wireless power. What we did is very simple. I selected the power cord and I used the mother-in-law filter. You know the mother-in-law filter? You select something, you press del and it's gone. Everything you don't like, select, del, gone. Mother-in-law filter. Sorry for the good mother-in-law, by the way. Now, very simple. A lot of people ask me, what kind of power connectors do you use? Or what kind of power cables do you use? Black? No, because when I shoot dark, I use white. And you know why? Because Photoshop is much easier in selecting white and removing it from a black background than if you use black. Now imagine this, you have a black cord and you go like, okay, see the black cord, okay, there it's gone. And somebody has their monitor on the wrong setting, so too much brightness, or you have this beautiful, especially Windows machine, sorry, and you look under an angle, and you see way more shadow detail than you should, and you see a cable going like, oh, now it's gone. Bad retouch. So if you make it white, you can actually see the cable very, very easily, and you have to take it out anyway, so make it as obvious as possible, so you can clone it out easier. Expression. But most of all, learn lighting. Because as soon as you learn lighting, you can add some extra stuff to your images. One of the things that I actually start the book with, if you shoot a model in jeans and tank top, you better be a lighting wizard. For the very simple reason, there's nothing else going on. As soon as you start doing the funky stuff that you're gonna see in a moment, the very weird styling stuff, the extreme stuff, lighting isn't that important anymore. I won't say that lighting isn't important, because it's incredibly important. But you don't have to cover everything. If I shoot with a 1.9 meter softbox, the images, the styling that Nadine does, all the images will look awesome. You will go like, that's an awesome shot. Because the styling is there, and you look at the styling and you go like, wow, this is great, the storytelling is there. Now add a little bit of lighting, and you're teaching at B&H. Oh, that's the tip, don't learn lighting, guys, don't. So with lighting, I can actually pinpoint this. Now, how many strobes is this? Only one. But I used it under a very, very tight angle. Up, aim down, and use it with the grid. This is a 70 centimeter octa from Elingrom with a honeycomb grid. And it actually spreads out the nice light very easily. He's standing against the wall, and the vignetting. A lot of people say, oh, that was edited in Photoshop. Why? Because I can't pull it off. That's the main problem. If you see something that you can't pull off, it has to be Photoshop, right? I hate Photoshop. I love Photoshop, but I hate spending too much time with it. So if I can make the vignetting right in camera, I will do it. So that's why we use grids. If you look at a lot of my videos, everything is gridded. Why? Because I have control. And if I have control, I can do whatever I want. Backlighting, very, very dark. Only contouring can make an awesome shot. Is this the sun? No, it's a strobe. What's the difference between the sun and a strobe? A strobe I can control, the sun I can't. I can control the sun, but not as much as I can control my strobes. And keep the strobe in the frame just a little bit. This is actually something else that we did. During Photokina's professional imaging, focus on imaging, whatever, all these shows, you can do the same thing over and over again. You can show your images. You can talk. You can grab a camera and go like, hey, I'm Frank. Look at this. Awesome, right? Look at this. Awesome, right? Yeah, I know. And people go like, awesome, Frank. But if you don't like me, people will go like, oh, that's Frank. Let's go. I always think and I always aim for the people that don't like me. If those people stand at the booth, they come in and they go like, I hate Frank. And they go away and they go like, he's pretty handy with lights. Then I succeeded. All the people that already like my work will get something out of it anyway. But I aim for those people who don't like me. And what I did here was actually something by pure accident. I wanted to play with a Lens Baby. And Lens Baby has a great new Lens Baby out. And it's already out for a while now. I think it's the 85. It's a tilt lens. And one of the problems with the tilt lens, especially with the cheaper ones and the Lens Baby, it's not cheap, but it is cheap, is lens flare. Oh man, lens flare is terrible. So at one point I was holding my hand beneath the lens because I was shooting inside the light. So shooting like this, showing what you could do with the tilt lens. I said, this is pretty cool, selective focusing. And one of the guys actually said, Frank, why do you keep your hand across the lens? I said, well, the lens is very prone to lens flare. I said, I will show you. So I took away my hand, I shot, everything was white. And I said, from the top of my mind, I said, you know what, you can play with this. And I started doing this with my fingers. And this is one of those shots. So afterwards, he came to me, he said, Frank, that was great that you figured that out and now do it on stage. I said, dude, I figured it out on stage. And why? Because I know what lighting does. So I know if my hand blocks it completely and I take it away and it's there, what will happen if I start doing it with my fingers? That's why you have to learn lighting, because sometimes you will be in situations where you are and your client asks you something and you go like, excuse me, you want me to do what? And he goes like, yeah, can you turn the background like totally white and then the foreground with a little bit of lens flare, like it's like there's a mist. You go like, no. You go like, oh, you're a photographer, right? You can do what I want. And it's actually pretty simple. If you want mist, what do? You get a lens that's very prone to lens flare. And you take the lens flare from the side and you've missed. If you have a lens that's not so prone to lens flare, what do? You breathe on your lens. And you shoot. Don't do it in front of a model that's already a little bit like, this is a really scary dude. And you go like, I'm going to take a really cool shot of you. Watch this. So you go like, you will get the expression, but it's the wrong one. Masks. One of the most important things is expression, right? Eyes, mouth. The whole face, right? What will happen if you take away the face? Something pretty interesting, because now you have to rely on the whole body. One of the things that I love to teach students, if you really want to get better in photography, you really want to get good at model photography, make absolutely sure that you try a few sessions with masks. Because now it gets very important how to tell the story, because there's no expression anymore. But you see the image, how much expression there is in the image? And you know why? Look at her pose. She's sad, right? Or for somebody else, she's dead and she's walking like this. It can be anything you want. That's why I never give any quotes with my images. Some people will go like whole stories. I once was in a museum and it was an exhibition and it was an awesome shot. Great, great shot. And I talked to Annewiek and I said, well, man, I see this story and it's amazing and it's this and this and that. And the artist was standing behind me. And she came up to me and she said, Frank, the story is totally different. I said, oh, tell me. And she told her story. And I was going like, if you wanted to tell that story, I would have changed this, 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 this. And she looked at me. She said, dude, you're right. I said, don't tell stories. If somebody tells me, oh, man, Frank, I love this one because he's very sad, I will go like, yeah. Cool, right? If you come up and you say, oh man, this is my favorite shot of you because she's so angry, I will go like, uh-huh, yeah, cool, right? I will never lie, because if you lie, you have to remember to who you said it. It's your story. It's your imagination. Do with it. So masks, they're very, very cheap. They're like 2-3 euros. You can do crazy stuff. This one is, believe it or not, this is a little kitty mask. Or how's it called? Little Kitty?
Hello Kitty.
Hello Kitty, yeah. Totally different Hello Kitty than I know. Expression. You see the expression, if you only use an eye mask, everything is drawn towards the eyes because that's the most important thing in a model. Close the eyes. That's wrong. You can never shoot a model with closed eyes. Why not? Know the rules, break the rules. This actually, it's just between us. They will cut this one out. Don't, by the way, but if you have a really ugly model, masks are a gift. It saves you so much skin work. Like if the model comes in, yeah, I ate the whole Hershey factory yesterday. They go like, I can see. I need some sanding paper, and I found it. Just give her a mask. We call it also Modelzillas, but that's something else. Now you see something else in this image. What makes it interesting? The styling, the heels, the mask, but also something else. And that's called composition, leading lines, and something, and I hope I pronounce this correct, chiaroscuro. Chiaroscuro? Chiaroscuro. Thank you. It's perfect. Dark, white, dark, white, dark, white, dark, white. The fun part is, I've been doing this for years without knowing it. And then at one time I saw a forum and somebody said, man, you're a master of chiaroscuro. And I said, thank you very much. And I opened up another tab. I read it and was going like, yep, now I know what I've been doing all these years. black, white, or dark, light. But look at the depth you get. So Frank, you used a lot of strobes for this, right? Nope, one strobe on the model. Then how did I get all this? Thanks to our sun. Make sure that you're at the right time, at the right place. And you can see it, guys. A lot of people don't look. I see so many photographers going like, oh, great location. And I go like, crap location. Look the other way. And they go, and they shoot, and they look at their images, and they go like, I don't like this location. I was like, you see the location right in front of you. Turn around. Wow, that's awesome. And I also make those mistakes sometimes. I will show you that in a moment. Composition, most important thing. And this is also the most difficult thing. Now, some people will say, you know what? Rule of thirds. And do you have something here called the golden snit?
Yes.
Okay, that's, I think it's, no. That's something else. The rule of thirds is equal division. And the golden snit is actually like a little bit off-centered. If you put your subject there, it's always right. But it's also always boring. But it always works, that's true. If you're like drunk and you take a picture and you use the golden rule or you use the rule of thirds, you get a great image. But there's so much more. If you look at this image, it's okay. You see the location, but you also see something that I actually hate in those kind of pictures. Yeah, Frank, I've been to a beautiful beach in California. And I've took all these model shots, and I look at all these model shots, and what do you see? A model laying on the beach, and you only see the sand and the model. And I actually gave his remark. I said, I don't know that you're in California. I only see a model in sand. I can do that in my studio. No, because the light in California was awesome. It's all flat. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I used a diffusion panel. A what? A diffusion panel. Thank you, Dutch. And anyway, so, and I don't see that location, right? So what I always say is go down on your knees and shoot something with a lifeguard house in the back. Then you know that you're in at least America because those lifeguard houses are pretty unique. So how do you do it? Same location. Slightly different shot. And I'm breaking all the rules here. I'm letting my model look that way instead of that way. And why? And you have to promise me that you won't tell anybody else. Promise me this will stay between us. Yeah, don't tell anybody. And for you viewers, don't tell anybody else. This is between you and me. We are hardwired in our brains to read from left to right, from top to bottom. If you want somebody to look really long at your images, make sure your attention point points them that way. If you look at this image, there's a very strong line. So you are actually forced to look outside the image. By having my model here and looking that way, I'm actually forcing myself again to keep trapping myself in the image. It will only work two or three times, but if you're a judge and I don't do it like this and I let her look that way, the judge will go after one look, okay, next image. And now they're actually forced, like, oh, interesting, oh, yeah, next image. And they look twice. Now, if you're a really bad photographer, make sure it leaves the image right away. Yeah? Same with logos. I have that little red logo on it, Studio FD. And a lot of people ask me, why is it always there? Now you know. Because you look at your image, you go like this, oh, nice logo. Oh, okay, leave the image. So look twice as long. If I put it here, you will probably not even see your face because the logo is that bright, people go like, oh, next image. Yeah, it's pure psychology. Leading lines. Now you see all these models with jumps and movement with me. Why is this model so at ease? So very, very relaxed. Imagine this model jumping around. You will miss all the leading lines. You will miss the framing. You will miss everything else. So sometimes you have to know when your model has to be expressive or when your model is just relaxed. Same here. Place her inside all the leading lines, all the light. And you see the same trick. She looks that way to make sure that you don't leave the image there. You keep coming back. Movement. One of the things I love to do, movement. Now, in the old days, I love those days, especially for me. You put a big black cloth over your face and you were gone. Awesome. And you were just standing behind your camera doing some stuff and the model was in front of the camera. Nobody saw the photographer. Awesome days. And then at one point you just said, okay, here we go. Hold your breath. Don't turn into a Smurf. Oh, it doesn't matter. We're shooting black and white. There we go. Hold your breath. Hold your breath, hold your breath, hold your breath. Don't fall down. Don't breathe, don't blink. Yeah, you're done. That was the old days, right? 20, 30 second exposures. You had these posing stools with stuff in the back. Then flash photography came out. And flash photography made it possible to do this. Okay, done, right? And what did a lot of photographers do? Okay, pose against the posing stool, stand there. Okay, hold your breath, done. They didn't change anything. Why? Because it worked. So why would you change? You remember what I said before? If you do something that's really successful, do something else. Photographers like Avedon, David Bailey, they all started doing funky stuff, models moving around. Gia, one of the first top models. Why? Because she moved around. She did stuff that no other model did. And that's why she was very popular. And that's movement, because now we can freeze action. So what does it do for a shot? Very simple. You can just make your model levitate. Just a little bit. This is no strobes, just natural light. And I now see that I have to clone something out. Because... very, very simple. But very effective. It can also be a little bit more drastic. This is Lorenzo from So You Think You Can Dance in the Netherlands, and he played in a movie. Edit with a little bit more expression. He can go anywhere. Oh, this is, by the way, another trick. And again, this is between us, viewers. Don't tell anybody. If you mess up a shot, like in this shot, the focus is okay, but it's not perfect. Make it black and white, add a lot of noise, and it's instant art. People will go like, man, I love that hinge of movement, that little bit out of focus part, you're a genius. I go like, thank you. But if I would post it in color, people will go like, dude, did you know that the eyes aren't sharp? Yeah, I know, but I like the shot. Yeah, but it's technical, it's wrong. Okay, one moment, add contrast, add noise. How do you like it like this? Oh, you're a genius. So just add a little bit of noise. This is actually a material called organza. At my first Kelby training, now Kelby 1 video, I called it fire cloth. We are still getting emails from people, where can I buy fire cloth? It's organza. So we find the seller actually I bought it from said it's fire cloth. So also on the videos I said it's fire cloth, but it's organza. It's very light material, works very well with wind or just movement. It's very cool, you can get it in all kinds of colors. And it's see-through, so you can see the face behind it. same material. Confetti cannons, also fun, especially when you have to clean up. This is where assistants really help. Now, which one of you guys has an assistant? Cool. You can all have assistants. This is a little trick again. If you want to have an assistant, Frank, they're expensive. No, they aren't. They're free. And we're Dutch, trust me, I know. If it's free, we Dutch people know. So, sorry for the Dutch viewers, by the way. I can't help it. As soon as you have a friend, now imagine this. We live the dream, right? We shoot photography. People don't realize how hard work it is, because this morning I was thinking about canceling because I was so sick, and I'm better again, so that's cool. A little bit of jet lag. And this is really hard. Imagine this, you fly in. We had an 18-hour travel because we did the bus to JFK and we were picked up there by a friend going from Newark to JFK in rush hour. I was sitting in the bus and I was almost throwing up, and it was for 3 hours, 2 hours in front of customs, and now I'm here. So it's really intense, but I love it. I wouldn't do anything else for the world. But most people, they go to their work. They sit in a cubicle all day, picking up phones, working with spreadsheets. They go home and they play with their trains, or they do photography, or they do whatever hobby they have, work on a Harley Davidson. I don't care, but they do their hobby. We do it all the time. Now imagine this, asking a friend, hey dude, I have this photo shoot tomorrow. Great model, wind, confetti, and I need, yeah. I didn't even complete my sentence. Yeah, but I will be there. You're actually giving them a day off. A day to freak, to show cool stuff. Don't abuse them. Make a nice print after that they helped you. But assistants can be free. The only thing they have to do is they have to clean this stuff up. They have to hold a reflector panel. Don't feel bad. They love it. I would love it if somebody asked me, do you want to go on a shoot with, let's say, David LaChapelle? Man, I would cook, I would clean, I would do everything just to be there. So assistants can be free. Don't abuse them, by the way. Don't just go like, okay, you have to do this. Be nice. But assistants can be for free. You can have a lot of fun with them. So very, very slight. When we actually never do jumps that are all over the place. Sometimes. Outside, very aggressively cropped. I like that. By the way, you know why I aggressively cropped stuff like this? I did the same thing, and this is a tip that I got from Dave Black. I guess I got it from Dave Black, I don't know for sure. Is if you shoot sports, right, and you have a motocrosser, is that the correct term over here? Coming up to you, and you shoot with a 400 mil, all the way in the back, and you have his head and all the wheels in, and he's coming at you. You see all this dust, and you have this space on top and on the bottom. It's a cool shot. Now as an experiment, cut off part of his head and part of the wheels on the bottom, and look at the response of people. Oh my, was he that close? Yeah? Awesome! Because he's so close, he couldn't even fit in the frame. And that's what I did here. He's so close, he didn't even fit in the frame. And this was an accident, by the way. But but later on I thought, oh, good explanation of why it cropped. So a little bit of motion. Duo shots with motion. It's difficult, right, to do two people at the same time. So, okay, you stand there, and you do something. What? Just do something. Yeah, what? I don't know, do something. Okay. Yeah, you take the shot and you go like, this isn't interesting, right? The first thing you have to do is get dancers. Because dancers are most amazing things to work with. People to work with. And why dancers? They're very expressive. They know what they're doing, they know their bodies, they know how to find the perfect pose, and they will do everything you ask. Jump high, okay, we'll jump high. And they can do it over and over again. So can you do the same jump? Yes, a normal model can do that. She will jump, can you do the same one? I will try, and it looks different. Like dancers, like the Lorenzo you saw before, if he did a jump, he could do the same jump over and over again, exactly the same way. Only the clothing would be different, but the same jumps. So duos, very intense. Chairs also help. But try that kind of stuff. Now, how do you get dancers? Very simple. Ask your local dance school. A lot of people are afraid. I won't ask because they charge money. There's a difference. And again, I'm Dutch. We know how to get stuff for free. So after this, I have to talk to B&H. But I think they will win. Anyway, so we're Dutch. And one of the things that I love to do is get my models for free. But I also offer something in return. So I will not go to a dance school and I will say, okay, I'll need two dancers for a project I'm doing. And I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do shots like this. Do you have dancers that want to do this? Yeah, but we'll charge you this, okay. I will go to dance school and I will say, hey, I'm Frank, I'm doing a new series on movement. Here's some images. If you have anybody interested in doing this kind of stuff, we're willing to offer it for free. Really? For free? Yeah. Awesome! And you get your models for free. It's the difference between asking. It's the same with hairdressers, but I will tell that later. So movement with light. Sometimes you get new strobes. Did anybody here hear of the ELC units from Ellingrome? They're awesome. I got them, I think, a year before the release. And normally when I get something before release, I have to keep my mouth shut, of course, right? Because you sign a contract. And normally it's like they're a little bit faster, it's a little bit better, a little bit more megapixels, a little bit more Wi-Fi or whatever. It's nothing that you want to scream to people like, this is awesome. These strobes were like a disaster for me because there were so many new options and I couldn't tell anybody about it. And they kept pushing the release date forward. And I was going like, oh. And in my studio, there were all these ELCs with black tape over them. So all my students were coming in like going like, I thought you were using Ellingromes. Yeah. What are those black units? Yeah. Old versions. But what can you do? As soon as you get something new, throw out the old, right? Remember that one? And I did. Because those strobes can actually stroboscopic affect you. Huh? Anyway, you can get stroboscopic effects. This is with two strobes, one on this side, one on this side. And it's in a delay setting. So imagine this. The first strobe goes off and does 1, 2, 3. That takes about half a second. And then after half a second, this strobe goes off on full power, freezing the model. So you get this, 1, 2, 3, 1. It's like a symphony, 1, 2, 3, 1. It's a delay, so you use two strobes. You can do it even better. You can use the modeling lights from one strobe, and then at the end, in a delay, trigger the other one. Be creative. As soon as you see stuff like that, don't go like, oh, it's nice, it can do it, so let's set everything on F8 and shoot like we're normally doing. No, start experimenting with it. And you can do this with small flares also. They have a delayed setting, like a second curtain strobe. Actually, you can use one strobe on second curtain, one strobe on first. And you can do exactly the same thing, just change your shutter speed, because if you change the shutter speed, the first one will go off at the first curtain, the second one will go off at the second curtain, so you do exactly the same technique. Here we did the same thing, but also with in-between strobes. Now styling. This is what makes everything better. Which one of you guys ever worked with a stylist? Cool. Those guys and girls are crazy. And we need those. I once worked with a stylist and the only thing she did was, yeah, we have these three jeans and these three amazing t-shirts. And I go like, you're not a stylist, you're a personal shopper. And there's a big difference. It's the same with makeup artists. You have a makeup artist and you have a beauty specialist. The beauty specialist isn't a makeup artist, trust me. Because we, with strobes, shoot away about 70 to 80% of all the makeup. What a beauty specialist does is keep it below 20%, just a little bit. If you see a makeup artist work and you go outside, people will come up and they ask, 25 euros? Because the makeup is really big. Wrong joke. Oh, right joke. Yeah. Styling. Now, what is this? It's an incredibly expensive dress, right? Look at how the face is sculptured in the dress, and you see it's actually called the windy wave dress. Because you see the water of life. It's a circle of life with the water. And a beautiful carved out face that will fit anybody, right? That's the story. In reality, these are shears, the curtains you hang in front of your window and you see through. We took them off the window. We put them around an old wedding dress of the model, and I put wind on it. And at the first images, I said, Nadine, get it out of your face. Because it was blowing in her face. I said, get it out of your face, get it. Wait a minute, let it keep in your face. I shot 3-4 frames, and this one ended up at the front cover of the Ellengrom brochure in the Netherlands. And it just shears. After we're done, we put them back on the windows. Christmas wrapping paper, nothing more. Total costs, zero. Total time, 30 minutes. Christmas wrapping paper, same shoot. Plants, why not? Go a little bit more extreme with flowers. Cup and saucer. Oh yeah, we bought that one with a clip on the hair. I don't know, it's the same as Wi-Fi in airplanes and buses. You have Wi-Fi, you see it, but it doesn't work. Your experience too? We were in a Wi-Fi enabled bus. It's more a teasing bus. You see the Wi-Fi, but it doesn't work. And then you ask, why is the Wi-Fi working? Oh, you see the Wi-Fi, right? Yeah, but there's no internet. No, that's broken. Then why do you have Wi-Fi on the bus? Like, I can take over. Like, okay, he's going to the right. Watch this. I'm in logging in on Wi-Fi. Now you go to the left. And you see the bus going like, no, I will win. It's for internet. Then work. So that clip actually didn't work. Every time we put it in, it went like, vroom. I was like, uh-oh. Put it in again. Now, one of the things that is awesome is gaffer's tape. But we didn't have gaffer's tapes. We did have duct tape. Worked like a charm. Now, why should you use gaffer's tape and not duct tape? Hear your model scream when you take it off. There's a distinct difference between gaffer's tape and duct tape. Yep. What I told my model was, as soon as my makeup artist took it off, I said, I had this Chinese restaurant food yesterday. I have to go to the restroom really fast. Because I think I don't want to be there when they take it off. Our restroom is like 500 meters further. I heard her. So I waited for 10 minutes, doing some Facebook updates. Waited for another 10, did my Google Plus updates. Went back, and she was just calming down. She lost like a few hairs. But the image is cool. So we use gaffer's tape to, duct tape. Normally gaffer's tape. This is an old pallet. We just put it on the floor, put my foot on it, cluck, made a hole, put my model behind it and said, scream. This is klambu. Is that the correct term also here? Takes the mosquitoes away. You buy them for 6-7 euros. That's about $10. Klamboos? Mosquito nets. Yes, same thing. Just throw it over your model, put her in the in a nice, this is actually flower bed, and we just put it out of focus by shooting on a wide aperture and you're done. This is bubble wrap. Light from the side, gives it a little bit more structure, but it's very simple, it doesn't cost anything. Newspapers. One thing. One of my students emailed me. He said, Frank, look at this image. Awesome, right? I stole it from you. And I don't care. If you steal something from me, I love it. Because that means that it inspires you, right? I always say, make it a little bit better, because then you frustrate me. I told him, I said, I wouldn't post that picture. He said, why not? He said, it's a great image, right? Oh, is it because I stole it from you? I said, no, dude, really not. But if you have the obituaries here, that's not a good idea. And he was going like, dude, I didn't see that. I said, and you can't Photoshop it out. He said, no. I said, don't post the picture. So even if you do stuff like this, make sure that there's nothing weird here. You know what this is? That works. If you're having a cold, it sticks even better. This one is awesome, right? I will tell you two stories. The one I won't ever tell. This is awesome. This is, you have to be Frank for this. It's an amazing picture. You have to be a genius. Great model. We worked for many, many years on this concept. At one night, it just hit me. And then we started developing everything, made these little prints out. We write everything down, and then finally we came up with this, but you have to be a genius. Mm. A lot of people think that the image actually was created like this, because people come to me and said, Frank, this is one of your best shots ever. And I think it is, because it is awesome, because everything comes together. The reds, the smoke, the model, everything is cool. I love this image. You know how it really got made? We have a workshop, and during the workshops in New York, I will do the same thing a little bit different, and it's called Creativity to the Max. What we actually do is we dump our stylist with the group in a small room, and I'm not there. I don't want to be there for the very simple reason. I want to have the students seeing me, seeing the stuff for the first time, to see my thought process. I don't talk to my stylist. So she's doing all this stuff with the group, and she was going like, okay, we have this Christmas wrapping paper, there we go again. We make these little wafers of them and we put them on the model. What you see here are actually two chairs put together like this, and we put something over it, like a normal material, I don't know exactly how to call it, but like a sheet, black sheet. And what they did is with gaffer's tape, they taped all these little papers on their chairs. So it looks like she's a dragon. And at that point, I was just thinking, what can I do with the light? What can I do with the light? And then I started imagining, you know what? We're going to have a little bit of smoke, a red strobe from here, one strip light from there, and that's it. Is it a shot that I took? Yes. Can I take the credit for it? Of course. I took the shot. There's only one big problem. Credit is where credit is due. And I think that I'm one of the few that will actually always say most of the credit goes to my students in this case and my stylist, because I was only the dumb person who pressed the shutter button. A lot of people will say, Frank, that's doing yourself way too short, because you figured out the light, you figured out the smoke, you timed everything correctly, you posed the model. I know, but posing the model in this case, that's just the topping of the iceberg. Because if the model was looking a little bit weird, so what? It's still a great image, right? But when everything comes together, that's when it clicks. And as if there are photographers here who say, a team isn't important, it's me, 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 you will never ever get better than you're now. You will actually get worse. Listen to other people. During one of my workshops, my stylist actually said something to me. I said, you know, we're gonna set this up against this wall, because I love it with the clothing. And Nadine walked up to me and she said, Frank, shouldn't you use that wall? I looked and said, oh, probably, yeah. And one of my students said, Frank, doesn't that feel bad that your stylist knows better than you? And I looked at him and said, we work together, it's a unit. You know the band Queen? You know that at one point they stopped labeling the songs? Brian May wrote this one, Roger Taylor wrote this one, Mercury wrote this one, and at one point they just said Queen. And why? Because they did it together. And that's what you do with your photography. Of course, it's a Frank Doorhof shot, but it's not my shot. So always remember this. Now, why do I say this? Very simple, to trigger in your minds that it's important to work with many, many people. And if you're this level and your assistant is that level, trust me, that level will sometimes lift you to that level. I heard Peter Hurley saying during a workshop he did in our studio, and I totally agree with him. The difference between the best photographer in the world and the number two is only this. The difference between you and that number two is only this. It's not like this. It's only this. But this is so incredibly important that it will make you number one. And it can sometimes be listening to somebody where you say, I'm way better than you. Just listen to those people. Curtains, nothing else. These are actually garbage bags. Made a lot of noise. Let's turn it up a little notch. Storytelling. Yeah, I don't know what story, but it freaks me out. The right model for the right shot. This one is actually pretty funny. I was doing a photo shoot. I was asked to come to an abandoned location with my model and, in this case, also stylist Nadine. And we walked in, and Nadine was wearing sweatpants and sweatshirt. So she was looking like nothing. She looked okay, but she was not like looking a model or stylist, just sweatshirts and walking like this, like, oh man. And then we walked past the photographer, and he had a model with him. And He said, "Hey, Frank, good to see you here. If you want to have a real model, you can borrow mine." I was going like, dude, really, this is so two-dimensional and actually a little bit offending to my model. So I looked at him and said, "Okay, what dresses did she bring?" "Yeah, this is the clothing that she's wearing." And this, I kid you not, this is why I started my book. If you're shooting a model in jeans and tank top, you better be a lighting wizard, because she was wearing jeans and tank tops. And the only thing he said, "But she's such a good model, it doesn't matter what she's wearing." And that's so wrong on so many spots. So anyway, they asked me 3 or 4 times while Nadine was preparing this. "Yeah, Frank, oh, I love the way you set it up." And we did some test shots, right, with the smoke and the lights, because I like if my model is on the set, we take 3 or 4 shots, because then they have the most powerful poses, and then we're done. So in this case, we used, I think, 3 or 4 strobes. For us, that's very much. And I wanted to have it perfect if Nadine comes up. And the model was going like, "Yeah, Frank, so if you want to shoot a real model, I'm here, I'm available." You know Roadrunner? You know how Willy Coyote sometimes look? With his face going all the way to the floor? There was that expression when Nadine comes into the set. With all this stuff. You saw the model going like... "What?" She never asked me if I would shoot her again during that day. The only thing she said is, "Wow." That's the difference between don't judge a book by its cover. Because she's incredibly creative. You know what all this stuff is? Cardboard. We threw it away on the spot. She created it in about 45 minutes and we threw it away. Don't bring it home, because we only use stuff once. The only thing I photoshopped away here is an Ellingrom Ranger aimed at my model, and I shopped that away. Why? Normally I don't do it, but sometimes you have to, because you want a certain amount of light on your model, you want a certain focused beam, and you need that light over there. Then make sure you place your light somewhere where it's very easy to clone out. Some people will just throw in their lights and go like, "Oh, we'll clone it out later in Photoshop." No, it's just as important as the pose of your model. Place your light exactly at a spot that it's very easy to clone out, for example, in front of this window. Don't put it in front of this, you're nuts. You can never clone that out, it's terrible. Place it somewhere where you know, "I just have to do this." The mother-in-law filter will actually do it. Choose your angles. But most of all, again, styling, wigs, dresses, and especially the color red. You see that? You see that in a lot of my shoots. Find a painter called Caravaggio. If you're online, Caravaggio. Lens flare. Storytelling, styling. Now, why is that horsey there? It looked good. Yeah, baby. It does look good, right? It looks like it's planned. Again, I will tell you something that's a little bit of a secret, and a lot of professionals won't tell you this, but I believe if I want to inspire you guys, I have to tell you how this actually got existed, because otherwise you think I would never be that smart or accurate to do it there. I am neither. I don't. I just had this light set up, and I love this with a big rim lighting. This is constant lighting, by the way. So I only had this strobe on my model and one from the side, and I looked at it and was going like, "This is awesome. I love it." The only thing is, I didn't like this. The whole white spot over here drew my attention. I was going like, how to solve this? And I saw the horse, I just put it in there. Done. And now it's part of the shoot. If you have a problem, and you can take it out, put something in it. And then it looks like it was intentional. People go like, "You're a genius." And I go like, "I will tell you how it really happened." And some people will look less of me because they say, "Oh, Frank, I thought you thought that out." Well, okay. But I think a lot of people now will actually think like, "I can do this." And that's when I succeed. If you say I can do this. DeLoreans. This is a technique I call black canvas. You come somewhere and everything is so incredibly bad that the only thing you can do is put your strobes so high that you blow out everything. Oh, sorry, that you take out every available light. So everything will be black. And then you start adding strobes. That's the black canvas technique. When there's a black canvas technique, there's also a white canvas technique. Everything is perfect. Just shoot it with natural light. Stay away from the strobes. And there are 50 shades in between. Gray. And that's where you do one strobe, just a little bit, or a little bit more strobe, or just a little bit more strobe, or just a lot more strobes. Black and white. Now, how does this happen? Very simple. I got a call. Frank, do you want to shoot DeLoreans? And I was going like, is the world round? He said, what do you mean? I said, of course I want to shoot DeLoreans, but can I bring a model? Well, we're not so happy that you bring a model, but if it's really necessary, I don't think people will like you shooting their DeLoreans with a model, but you know what, you can shoot my DeLorean. Okay, can I bring a smoke machine? Yeah, okay, cool. What they all thought, that I would shoot a model laying on the hood of the car being sexy, right? When Nadine came out like this, and I set up the lights like this, if you're ever in the Netherlands and you need 25 DeLoreans, I have them all on speed dial. Because they went from, no way, Jose, you will never ever shoot a model near my DeLorean. They saw these shots and they go like, can you also do that with my DeLorean? No, because you didn't want to. And I didn't have time. This is, by the way, photoshopped. Those didn't have enough intensity to show up because we have to blow out all the natural light. So we had to Photoshop this in. How do you do it? Very, very simple. I'm not a Photoshop guru. What you do is you make three layers empty. You paint in with white, very, very thick on the where the light bulb is. And you blur that just a little bit. Then you paint in the whole area here. And you blur that just a little bit more. And then you take a big brush and you do this. And you blur that a lot. And then you have headlights that are actually on. Same here. I love the backlighting. That's something you see a lot in my shots. And of course, again, storytelling and red, the color red. You see that in a lot of my work. And smoke. Move around. That's what a lot of photographers forget to do. We move. I see a lot of studios where there's this little spot in the center that's totally worn out. That's where the photographer stands. If you look at my studio, all the places I walk. And this is the same shot as this shot. Same light, as this shot. Same light setup. The only difference is here I'm shooting into the strobe. And with this one I'm actually moving around and standing here and shooting on the side of the strobe. How does this happen? Very simple. They took me to Nevada with the airplane. And believe it or not, the model happens to have angel wings in the car. The only thing I said, bring a red dress. And she said, well, I have something else in the car, angel wings. And I go like, what? Take them out, cool. And we did the shot. I always said I will never ever shoot on a graveyard. I think that's, how do you call it? Not nice.
Disrespectful.
However, when you get a mood board, and you get a great team, I did it once, and I will never ever repeat it again. But if I see the images, I'm glad I did. And here's another tip for you guys. If you shoot on a location like this, I don't know how it's in the US, but with us it's legal. We don't need a permit, we just go and we shoot. And you can bring smoke machines, you can bring gas generators, it doesn't matter. You can do whatever you want. There's one problem. You see that it's a very old graveyard, meaning it's in a community with us that's rather religious. And I knew that people would come up at me and going like, Frank, what are you doing? And now there are two scenarios. One, I'm shooting. Okay, thank you. And they go. That's the most unlikely scenario. The other scenario is I'm shooting. Yeah, we don't want that. Yeah, but it's legal. Oh yeah, we're gonna call the cops. Now in the Netherlands, calling the cops is not like in New York calling the cops. You will have to wait for an hour. So then the cops come in. Go like, Mr. Doorhof, thank you. What are you doing? Doing a photo shoot. On a graveyard. Yeah. Why did you call us? Isn't that illegal? I don't know. Central? Is it illegal to shoot on a graveyard? Oh, is Doorhof shooting again? Yeah, okay. I have to find that up. One moment. No, it's not illegal. Thank you. The smarter way to do this is very simple. You go to your county. I don't know if it's the same here, but your courthouse, county house, whatever, government house, for your local area, and you go and you get a permit. So I went to the government. I let my assistant and a week go to the government house, I have to be honest, and said, I want a permit. They're €7.50, 10 bucks. And they said, you don't need one. I said, I want one. Why? I don't care, don't you want to earn $10? We'll write something for you up, dude, no problem. Where do you want to shoot? There, Kaunre, okay. When? Tomorrow, okay. It's your $10. Here you go, it's your $10, wasted money because it's legal. Now imagine this, we were there, we had the smoke machines on, people came in, dude, what are you doing? Do you know this is a graveyard? And I wanted to do like this. Really? I didn't know that. I thought it was McDonald's. Bad joke. Anyway, so, and people came up and they were really not aggressive, but like attacking, you know? So, dude, you know this is graveyard, right? Yeah, I have a permit. Oh, cool. Nice shots. Now, that's a totally different story than calling the cops, right? So even if you know you're right, get a permit because it saves you so much hassle. Because if you're waiting for an hour, it can rain. It's the Netherlands. It can rain. More people come. It's a terrible situation. Now, sometimes, by the way, and this is a street. Are you also in for a street photography tip very quickly? Okay. Sometimes people will harass you if you shoot on the street, right? They go like, you can't shoot here. I had it in front of the Hilton in London. I was taking a shot. I was a guest at the Hilton at that point. Taking a shot. Sir, you can't shoot here. And I know that I can shoot there. But I don't want to have the discussion with that lady. So I said, why not? Because this is the Hilton. I said, you know, according to Article 44 in your own law book, it's allowed to shoot even on public spaces, from an open road to even government buildings, unless under subsection A, there is police. And I gave her this whole stuff, subsection B, subsection C, and she looked like, okay. There is no 44, there is no A, B, C, or whatever. It works all the time. Unless you have a lawyer in front of you, then run. This is actually the one I was talking about moving around. And again, movement, storytelling, styling. This is during a workshop I did in the UK. And if the student is watching, probably he is. He knows this is the truth. I was explaining something, and imagine this, I was standing like this, and there's this big, huge castle. And I was explaining how we can lower the luminosity on the castle by using reflective metering, setting up the strobes, and then getting a cool shot. But before I do the workshop, I always tell my students, if you think you can do better, and I really mean this, if you think you can do better, just ask. Oh, okay. And he said, Frank, you said that I could interfere if I think I could better, right? Yeah. He said, if you turn around, don't you like that way better? And I turned around, and you see this beautiful line. And the other picture I had to take out, and there you see it even better. It's like it's divided into two. You have this beautiful garden, and on the other side, it's a little bit less. On my website, you can see the image. It's a way better shot, so always open up for that kind of critic, because, not critic, for that kind of input, because I get a way better shot this way. Thanks to my students, and thanks to moving around. A location where you shoot is three-dimensional. Walk around, find all the angles. One strobe, right at the model, red, red. Make sure that your styling fits. Same problem, lighting problem. During daytime, harsh light on my model, way ugly shadows over here. Terrible shadows. So I said to my students, okay guys, here you go. You can't change anything, solve it. And they went like, okay, solve it? Well, I can't solve this. How should I solve big, harsh, ugly shadows? And I go like, I don't care, solve it. And they went like, okay, can I move that? No. Can I move? No. Can I change? No. But Frank, then it's unsolvable. And then I put that saddle, and I just throw it in the shadows. And what do you get? Beautiful lit saddles. Solve it with something that you put in the set, because now the shadows are gone, but you get a beautiful rim lighting. See that? Don't solve problems by adding strobes or changing stuff. Solve problems by understanding light. Light is your language. Make sure that you understand it, because then you know if I put the saddle there, all the shadows will actually fall under the saddle, but you get this beautiful rim lighted saddle. Playing with everything. There's no stopping to playing. You should always play. For example, do you see this little, let me make it a little bit clearer. Do you see this stuff? Took me for ages in Photoshop. Do you believe that?
No.
Why not? I don't like Photoshop that much. What I did, just before the photo shoot, put my hands on the floor, make my hands dirty with dust and sand, put it over my lens, and shoot straight into a light source. What do you get when you have a dirty lens and you shoot straight into a light source? Stardust. What do you have when you have a dirty lens and you just shoot on the street in New York? You see nothing. That's why if you buy a second-hand lens, and this is something a lot of people don't tell you, oh, it's scratched. You won't see it in a picture. They're half lying. You won't see it in a picture unless you're shooting straight into a light source. If you buy a second-hand lens and you're in doubt if you see scratches, turn towards a light bulb, shoot into the light bulb, and then zoom in. If you see discoloration, don't buy the lens. If you don't see it, you're pretty safe. Throw with this kind of stuff, but be very, very careful because this is incredibly dangerous. Ever heard about kinetic explosions? I hope that's the correct term over here. No, that's something else. This is when you throw stuff up and you have the combination of oxygen, kinetic energy, static electricity, and strobes. Big bada boom. If you aren't careful. Water, also nice. And that brings us to the next part, color. Color can be very strong, reds. Color can be very interesting with paint. Make sure that you get paint that's skin friendly. And you also see that we took precautions because under her eyes, this is makeup. So we wanted to get this shot, but I'm showing you this shot. This is the first shot we took. This is where we actually had the makeup and then we poured the paint. And this shot is actually in the seminars for one simple reason. A lot of people think that we did this also with paint. This is nuts. If you do this with paint, you will hurt your model and she will probably have, unstoken eyes, irritated eyes, infection in her eyes or whatever, irritated eyes. So make sure this is makeup and then fit the makeup on the paint, of course, but your makeup artist can do that. And then you get a cool shot. Strong reds. Colors, secondary colors, primary colors. The secondary colors are yellow, magenta, cyan, and of course, black if you do the CMYK. The primary colors are red, green, and blue. Combine those two and you get something really interesting. Yellows, with a little bit of coloring in Photoshop. Wide angles. Now, one of the things that people say you should never ever use for a model shoot, wide angles, right? Those are evil. If you know how to use them, they can be very cool. For example, here, I'm laying on the floor, one strobe aiming up at the ceiling, and we could take this shot. The nice thing about wide angles is if you sit on the floor and you aim it up, your model looks taller. If you like your models, make her look taller. If you don't like your mother-in-law, try the content-aware fill. Wide angle, get the whole area in, don't laugh, get the whole area. Somebody's mother-in-law is now watching. Take the whole area in. And again, you see, tell the story and that little accent. Some models are crazy. I love them. She's actually hanging in the gate. But also shot with wide angles. Because with wide angle, I can get the whole building in. Wide angle in an alley. No, not alley. Hallway, thank you. Normally, I don't teach. Unless I'm 3 days in the States. You laugh, but English is not my native tongue. So when I'm just flying in, I'm still half Dutch, half English. As soon as I'm here 3 days and I'm chatting with friends, my English will get better. So now it's at its worst. Wide angles from a low angle. And now what I do with wide angles is very important that you do the same thing. Don't shoot with a wide angle as it is a normal lens, because that's when people say don't shoot with wide angles. Shoot with a wide angle as is it is a wide angle. So lay on the floor, aim up, get those converting verticals, get those crazy stuff in your image. That's when you use wide angles. And then it gets cool and crazy. Small accent, sneakers under a wedding dress. crazy professor. And by the way, with these kind of shots, some people think, oh, that's all thrown together. Look at the colors. If I would have changed the red one for the blue one, the whole picture wouldn't work. If we change the green one for the blue one, it wouldn't work because you have green, green, green. Huh? So think about every small detail. And this is very tiresome sometimes, because sometimes we do the shot and we look at it and awesome, great expression, everything is cool. Uh-oh, don't like the combination of colors. Then do it again, or use Photoshop. Change something with wide angles. In this case, a very simple bicycle lane. By using a wide angle, we created something I called my Alice in Wonderland. Wide angle, make sure that you see the distortion, because now people don't say, ooh, I don't like the way it looks because you shot it with a wide angle. Now people will say, cool, you shot it with a wide angle because you actually get the shoe in front. This is actually our studio. I always love it when people come in and they come for workshops and they look at our studio and they go like, dude, crazy space, man, awesome. Nice. When are you gonna remodel the walls? Because all my walls have different structures, different colors. This is the worst, by the way. And I look at them and I say, dude, those are backgrounds. And they go like, awesome. That's when I already earned my money. Because with a lot of people, there's a switch here. And that's on the off setting. And I call it the creativity switch. They see something and they don't see the options. How many studios did you visit that are totally white all around? Wasted space. Get 2.5 meters. That's how many feet? 9 feet? Paint it. Get another 9 feet. Paint it. Get another 9 feet. Paint it. Make different structures. Use wallpaper. Whatever you do. Every part of our studios, 9 feet, different setting. 9 feet, different setting. 9 feet, different setting. And sometimes we have 18 feet, but we let it slide out. For example, we have a gray wall, and it goes from a darker setting to a wider setting, and it's fading in the middle. You know why? Very simple. If I shoot that way, I have light fall off that actually goes on way longer because it's a lighter wall I'm shooting in. If I'm shooting from that way, the light fall off is incredibly quick because I'm actually shooting into a darker wall. Because the light is faded in the middle in the paint, people don't see it. If they stop in the studio, they go like, dude, that 1 meter, why is that faded? And then I set the lights up and they go, that, dude, that's awesome. But we've been doing this for many, many years. And in the past, I didn't do it. So in the new studio, we did. So all these walls, try it in your own studio. But Frank, my studio is in my living room. Awesome. Don't you want your living room to be looking a little bit more interesting than your normal living room? So use different wallpapers. You have 4 walls. Unless you're homeless, but then you don't have any walls. Hair, one of the most interesting things to play with. This is interesting. This is actually a normal model shoot. You see the face, you see the hair. Well, but if you make it like this, also helps with Photoshop. But for me, this image is much more interesting. And why? What's going on? I don't know. But it intrigues me. And when I look at this image, it's like, okay, cool, next. Ooh, if I'm a judge, this one will get a good mark. It's lighting-wise, it's okay. You see both arms. It's an okay shot. If I look at this one, I say, ooh, you dare. So make sure you do something interesting with it. Hairs, a little bit of expression combined. On the boat, I was feeling a little bit better. This is on the way back. And the wind in the hair, why not? Just experiment. Very simple poses can be very interesting if you start playing with hairs. And of course, sometimes a little bit of hairspray and backlighting. Always backlight stuff like this. Now, how do you get hairdressers to work for you? How? Because those are expensive hairdressers, especially with the creative stuff. It's the difference between asking. You can do two things. One, you go to your hairdresser and you go like, hey, I love the way you dress hair. Great, it's my favorite. Do you want to work for me? And I want to do a series, can you do this or that? Oh yeah, sure, and they charge you, right? Or you go in like this, you go to your hairdresser, you sit down, you take a magazine, and very obnoxious, you start browsing through the magazine, and you start looking at images. You go like, hmm, and if she doesn't respond, you go like, hmm. At one point, she will look at you, and she will go like, do you like the images? Yeah, but you can do better. No, that's L'Oreal. It's all about the photography. Trust me, I've been doing this for years. Yeah, you can do better. I know you're creative. Really? You think I can do stuff like that? Yeah. Really? Do you want to try? Normally we charge like 500 euros for a shot, but you know, you're my hairdresser. I will do it for free for you. You only pay for the prints. Really? So I have my own prints in my own salon and I only pay for the prints. Yeah? Deal. Free hairdresser. Mm-hmm. They will do it, trust me. Is it cheating? No, because they get beautiful prints in their salon. Is it saving money? Of course. Sometimes you spend, sometimes you save. And you can do the most crazy stuff. This is black on black. They thought I was crazy. I wanted to do this. And when you go black on black, you always go even more extreme or white on white. This was a disaster. This is one of the reasons you should use a light meter. Metering this, and the projector is blowing it out slightly, the monitors are better. Metering that is an absolute nightmare. Because you are like 1/10 of a stop over and it's gone. That meant if the model did this, she was a little bit of a, what we call a flowing model. That she moved a little bit. So a lot of the shots were blown out and a lot of the shots were okay. Smoke. If something is not interesting, add smoke. You can use smoke like this, like a mist. Very, very slight. You hardly see that there's any smoke. So it's pretty interesting. Chicken wire, by the way, with colors again, organza. Or you can use it like this, but always backlight it. Now, why backlight? Very simple. Smoke and water, hairspray or whatever, are particles in the air. How do you light particles in the air? Imagine this. Do you ever have fog in New York? Yeah. We have it a lot. Now, if you drive with your car, what happens if you drive in the fog and you turn on your headlights? It's like a white curtain you look at and you go like, I can't see anything. That means that if I light smoke from the front, it will actually reflect back all my lighting because it's particles in the air. If you light it from the back, it will actually show up. And that's why you get this kind of stuff. Legoland? Really? Trust me. And if you're lucky, they will help you out. I said, can the dragon also smoke? Oh yeah, no problem. Now one thing, and I'm a very nice person. I'm like the teddy bear of photographers. I'm very kind. But at one point, I had my limits. Really. There are a lot of children in Legoland. Little girls, like ponytails. Beautiful. And we were shooting Nadine like this, and I had a group of 10 students. And one of the girls came up to me, sure, you're shooting a princess. And I looked at the girl and said, yeah. Do you like her? Yeah. Do you want to take a picture with her? Really, can I? Of course. So I took her hand, gave it to Nadine, and took a picture with the princess. How many children do you think there are in Legoland? The next time, and I will not do this, but the next time, sir, are you shooting a princess? No, it's a witch and she eats children. You can just go on with your shoot. Know when to be kind. No, the next time I will do the same thing again. It was so adorable. At one point, we had like 15, 16 children lined up to take a shot with the princess. I just looked at my students and said, you know, the workshop will take an hour longer. I'm very sorry, I didn't know this. Oh, no problem. Smoke can create something that's a little bit more fitting the story. Probably the album cover for Serena. She wanted something with motion. She wanted something that nobody else has on her album. And I said, then we go black and white and we do stuff like this. She loved it. It's a risk. Because if you put something like this on an album cover, it is different. But I also think that sometimes the difference between a good photo and a bad photo is being a successful artist or not. And a lot of people don't realize this. And this is why we charge for our photo shoots a normal fee. Yesterday we had a client future client. He's an artist. He wants his new album and he wants CD releases. He wants album covers. He wants flyers, everything I have to shoot. And I gave him our price and he said, dude, really, I'm willing to spend 100 euros. I said, do you realize that the difference between a 100 euro shot and my shot is probably that with my shot, if the music is good, you will end up in the top 10. And with the other shot, you will probably end up on Sky Radio or Radio 10. And that's with us, the radio senders, programs that just broadcast material. And it sounds arrogant. His music has to be great, otherwise he will never be in the top 10. But if you have a lousy picture on front of your image, you know that a lot of people just look at the image and go like amateur, don't even listen to the music. In the past, when I was young, I'm now 43, when I was 18, and I love the more hard rock music like Queen, Nightwish, that kind of stuff. When I was younger, there was a metal magazine and they reviewed CDs. You remember CDs? Yeah? Final, yes. Final CDs. And they reviewed CDs and they had this catern. Catern, is that the correct term? Like articles. And there were always three bands of the month. There were only three reviews because there were only three new bands. You know how many new bands there are now in the same magazine? 65. So how do you think they listen to all the CDs that come in or all the downloads that come in? They will just look at the picture, crap, boom. And you can be the best band in the world. Wow, great image. They listen to 10 seconds, crap music, and you're gone. So make sure you make an impression. The first thing they see is the image. And that's the same thing we tell to our clients if they do web shots for a web store. Which one of you guys shoots for CEOs or headshots or whatever? Okay, one of the things you have to tell your clients, and I always tell it, and it doesn't work because clients can be very obnoxious. You go to their website and they have a team of people and there are no images. It's the same thing. Would you buy from a web store? There's no telephone number. Would you buy there? No way. If it's somewhere else, 10% more expensive and they have a telephone number, I will buy there. But first I will call the telephone number. If they pick up, I'll say, hey, I was on your website. I will order something. Thank you very much. That's all. Or I will ask a question. If there's no telephone number, no. If you go somewhere and you want to take your headshot or you want to take your picture, what's very important? That you have a connection with the one that's shooting you. So if you go to our website, you will always find a headshot of me. If you go to our studio website, you will see a headshot of Anouk and me next to each other, just standing like this. It's very, very basic, a very simple headshot, just the two of us. Is it high class? No. Is it the best work I've ever done? No, it was just a selfie. Why is it important? People see Anouk, people see me, and we look nice. You know how many people actually say that that shot convinced them to go to my website? Actually, it's a little bit terrible for me because I would rather have people go to me for their portfolio. But if they say that headshot did it, yeah. So a lot of the companies we work for, they have this website and they have all these people headshots here. All different backgrounds, all different lighting, and it just looks terrible. And then you talk to them and you say, you know what? It's the internet. Your first expression or your first impression somebody gets from your company is from your website. For 75 euros a person, so that's 3 times 75 euros, we make a new web shot. How long does it take? 10 minutes max for all three persons. They come in, okay, stand, look that way, doof, next, doof, next, doof, done. And they have this beautiful, constant quality added to their website, done. I had one company, I kid you not, this is their website, square, and here were all the headshots. You know which side they looked? That way. You couldn't read the text. How hard you tried, you couldn't read the text. Why? Because all the headshots were looking that way, out of the frame. So I was reading the text and I looked at the headshots. Where are they looking? Oh, that's my other, no, that doesn't work. So I said, just mirror them. They didn't do it. Free advice, just mirror the headshots. Oh, we don't care, it's just our website. Educate your clients, and if you educate your clients, you will get more work. Smoke. Time machine for us. I love this shot. We did it in a workshop in, these are, by the way, trust me, these are all workshop shots you see, because most of the stuff I shoot during workshops is the interesting stuff. If I show you my commercial work, probably the room would be half empty now. Because it's not that interesting. It's just, it's nice stuff. But This is a mannequin. You know mannequins? Dress-up dolls for grown-ups. And we use them for props. We call them Eddie. Cameras. This actually started as a joke. I had this old camera, and I was out of luck one day, meaning I didn't know what to do. I gave my model a camera and said, do something. She was going like, okay. So I went with that shot. I went to our local camera store, like the B&H, but it's on Urk, called Camera Nu. And it's pretty big. It's the biggest one in the Netherlands. And I gave him the shots, and I know him very well. And I said, I want to do something with this. And they said, you know what? Go to our store, pick whatever you want, take it, use it. On the one condition, you bring it back. Okay. And we can use the images, but we will use your name and we won't use it for anything else than our own publication. Now, a lot of people will now go like, no way you did that, Frank, because that's giving away your work for free. And that's wrong. You agree? It's wrong to give away your work for free, right? Because hey, you have to know your value and you will never ever do something for free. I always told my grandma, and she passed away, that's very shameful, of course, because she didn't see my career develop the way it was. What she didn't understand, that sometimes I did stuff for 100% free. Why did I do the stuff for Camera Nu for free? One, I got an unlimited supply of cameras at the moment. Whenever there's a new brand or model out, I will get it. I can choose, I can just walk through the store. I want that one, I want that. Oh, that Leica in that color, that's awesome, give me one. And the personnel knows me, so they will just give it to me, and I will do the shots. The other thing is, they are the biggest in the Netherlands. I'm in all their commercials now. When you come up to their shop, it's huge. There's this 10 by 10 meters big sign high up with one of my images. My name is like this big. What do you think? I mostly teach. I teach workshops. What do you think all the photographers that see my name over there will go like, he must be a big shot that he shoots for Sony, because they don't know the deal I have with Camera Nu. I don't shoot for Sony, I shoot for Camera Nu. But the images look like they're for Sony because we put in the new Sony. They go like, oh, wow, cool. I do shoot for Sony, by the way, but that's a different story. But that's because we took those shots, because those shots actually ended up with the camera manufacturers. And then the camera manufacturers started calling us, can you do our shots? I was like, okay. So this is Leica, small Canon. Just being creative with stuff that you get. And this is another way to get yourself in the attention of, for example, Fuji. Use their products, send it to them. Oh, I really like this shot, can we use it? Yeah, let's talk money. One of my old cameras that I use. This is my own. Oh, and by the way, do you see this? This is all blown out. Sometimes when you go on a forum, people will burn you for this. And the problem is, and I'm really honest with this, and it sounds arrogant, and I don't mean it arrogant. If I put something like this on, people will go like, oh man, that's awesome. If somebody who's starting out puts something like this on, this is so wrong, because it's all blown out. Ignore those responses, please. If the image looks right, and it's an awesome shot, don't listen to all the other people. Just put it in there. Because for some people, black shadows are wrong, blown out areas are wrong. For me, if the story is correct, that's the shot. Go extreme, don't be afraid. Go all the way. Can be in Photoshop. Or with red gels. Don't be afraid, don't ever think this is too much. Because there is no too much. Sometimes, but most of the times, no. And some things work, some things don't. I love this one. I got one of my students who saw this. He said, this is the worst you ever did. Cool. No problem. He loves my work, so he didn't like this one. Great. You know what the problem is? If you try to shoot for everybody, you will always be like this. Middle road. Nice. It's the music that will play on the radio, and it's very popular. Everybody loves it. But is there a big following? No, because next week there will be something else. Try to go like that way. Man, I love this. Man, I hate this. Great. then go that way. And the one that hated that one will go like this, I really love. The one that loved that one will hate that one. And some people will love everything. That's cool. But go to extremes. Different lighting. It shouldn't always be strobes. This is black lights. Fluorescent paint and black lights. Thank you. Props, use props, don't be afraid. And don't use them because you need them. Use them because they add something. Put a model in a cage and say, I'm going to lunch. Great expression. Simple chair outside, natural light, no strobes. Why does it work? The combination of the white, the color combination, and the dress and the pose of the model. Look at the angles. Pets. Bring pets. Why not? Little dog. We didn't do anything with the dog afterwards, but we had a nice barbecue after this one. Very simple shots. Locations. Most simple locations. Just the elevator in our hotel room. Anne-Vic was holding one strobe here. That's all the lighting you see. Outside on the hotel. Long lens to compress everything. One strobe. Abandoned building. This was all, these shots that are now actually following were shot last week during a workshop. As you can see, I'm looking for everything. Repeated patterns, reflections, styling, storytelling, lighting, the arrow. This was fun, by the way. All the students were shooting it and they placed the model there. And I was going like, did you look at the wall? Yep. Okay, what did you see in the wall? I love the blue. Okay, what did you see in the wall more? I don't know. I said, do you see the angle over there? The arrow. Yep, I see the arrow. And why don't you place your model below the arrow? I go like, really? It's all that simple stuff. First look, then shoot. Light coming from the side. Use your doors as flags. You know what flags are? They block off the light. And you see that little window here? That let through the light. So now I'm actually using my environment to block light and to let through light, creating something that I could never ever do with a normal strobe. Masks and expression and side lighting. I love side lighting. A lot of people always light from camera angle or slightly off camera angle. I mostly shoot with the lighting over there, model here, and with my camera that way. Fighting the sun. Doing the totally opposite. In this case, the only thing we used is one strobe on the back. Now, a lot of people ask me, how does a light meter work? Frank, we know incident, we know reflective, but how does it work? Where do we point it, towards the camera or towards the light source? This is the most asked question. And if you look in books, there are two train of thoughts. One, point it always towards the light source. Two, point it always towards the camera. And both are wrong. Maybe a shocker. If you look at your light meter, what does it? It's an incident light meter, right? So it metered the light coming on the light meter, right? Now let's say that I'm the model and I want this part of my face to be correctly lit because I have, for example, the sun from this side. So I'm blowing out a little bit of my hair and I want this side to be correct because if I meter here, this side will be totally gone. How do I meter? Because I'm shooting from there. Train of thought one, aim towards the sun. This will be totally black. Train of thought two, meter towards the camera. So we'll meter here. This one will totally blow out. Incident meter readings, meter the light hitting the subject. On that area there you want it correct. So in this case, you hold your light meter here and you aim that way because you're meeting the ambient light. If you do it like that, you will always get the correct exposure. In the studio, it means 99.9% of the cases you shoot towards the light source with your light meter. You meter towards the light source. On location, you hardly meter towards the light source, only if you fight the sun or you use hard rim lighting or you use two strobes. But in this case, I metered her face. The light source over here, you can see it. It's totally blowing out the area behind her. It's totally blowing out the windows. She is actually lit by all the scatter light from the area, from that strobe. Now about storytelling, somebody said, why didn't you clone out the exit sign? Why? Very easy. Select it, press Del, and it's gone. For me, it's storytelling. I see this model here. She's looking fierce. I see this all this white light coming from here, and I see an exit sign. What's the story? Let your mind think about it. And if I take it out, it's less interesting for me. Big wave. See this? This is actually a pool of water, and she's just stamping her feet. And you know what this is? Some people think it's photoshopped. It's not. This is her dress. It was also organza material, very, very light stuff. What we did is we soaked it in the water, and I asked my model to pick up her dress and throw it up and then put her arms like this and just stamp to have the water in. Now you can actually see that I'm right, because you don't see the splash of water, because at the splash of the water, the dress was only here. So she had to take the position, move back and do this. And at that point, the dress, and this is very, very much luck, just created a wave. But it's no Photoshop at all, this image. Same here, light from the back, but moving to another position. No different strokes, only one. Play with your lights. This is the shot that you normally would take. Very flat, interesting, but it's also very flat. Same shot, but now only with one stroke. Sometimes more is less. No? Yeah, more is less. And less is better. Less is more, that's it. Just show your strokes, don't worry. Some people clone them out, why? They create something that gives atmosphere. It's nice. The sun and a little bit of strobe on her face, but you don't see the face. So what? It's not a model shot, this is a mood shot. Same here, the sun just creeping through. Two strobes, one from the front, one from the back, lowering the ambient. With a dark skin model, you should never do that. Why not? I give her two rim lights, so she will show up. And I didn't like the background. Black canvas technique, make it dark. Or use your strobes on a different way, combined with wide angles. Movement, everything comes together now, as you can see. This is a light bulb. Just a standard 100 watt light bulb, nothing more. Windows. Which one of you guys runs Windows? Mac?
Yeah.
And the rest doesn't have a computer? Or they're afraid to say that they use Windows? Microsoft, without any doubt, some of the nicest people I've ever met in the Netherlands. When I started using a touch tablet, they called me and they said, Frank, can we help you? Awesome. My Apple never called me. Microsoft did. They gave me all this stuff to test out. Awesome. In the end, I had one conclusion. Windows is not for me. It was just too buggy because when I used the normal software, it worked. But I use a lot of beta stuff and it just crashed way too much. So I stopped using Windows. And as a joke, and this is why I always tell people, this is a joke. I love both Windows and I love Mac. The only thing that Windows is really good in is letting through light, available light. Lens flare. And this one can drive people nuts, because I was shooting this image during a workshop. Doom, got it. Doom, got it. And I said to my students, now you try it. And they didn't get it. It was all flat looking, underexposed, and it drove them nuts. You know the big thing about this kind of shot? You can see what you're doing. Make sure that you see that light in the corner of your frame. And then move a little bit, that it's barely out of the frame. Then move back, that you just see a little bit of that light source, press the button, and you have lens flare. If you do it a little bit too much out of the frame, lens flare is gone. If you do it too much, your whole image will be white. So experiment. And the more wider angle you shoot, the better it works, and especially cheap lenses. Get like the cheapest Sigma lens or the cheapest Tamron lens and put it in your case just for special needs. They will lens flare like crazy. Don't try it with an L lens or a Zeiss lens. You will drive yourself nuts. You will never get lens flare. But do it with cheap lenses, M42 lenses. Second-hand department. Get a converter, use an M42 lens. Awesome, they will lens flare as soon as they see light. You go like, ooh. They're the vampire of lenses. Very simple light. I love this shot. I don't know why, but I just like it. And it's just window light. Same here, just sunlight. Sunlight. All available light is cool. Nothing more, no strobes needed. Now it sounds easy, right? Just shoot with the sun. Imagine this, shoot with strobes. What do you do with strobes? And this is the fun part. A lot of people do with strobes, they do everything carefully. And then they shoot with the sun and they just throw in the model and say, the sun sucks. And then they say, do you do the same thing with your strobes? Just throw in the model, strobes suck. No, of course not. You angle the light, but you can't do it with the sun. Of course you can't do it with the sun, but you can do it with yourself. If you look here, you can see that the sun is behind my model. And I'm having my model looking into the shadow area. What do I do with that? If I meter here, I'm actually blowing out my background a little bit, giving it that pastel look. But I also have her face correctly lit, and there are no raccoon eyes because there's no light hitting her face directly. So you're just playing with it. If you shoot this on AV mode, you will never know what gets out of it. But if you use a light meter, you can predict it and you can make beautiful shots. And then Photoshop, we're almost there. If you're in a creative mood, and I'm a bad Photoshopper, but I love to freak out sometimes. And I always do the crazy stuff. With me, you will see if it's Photoshop. Like this, I think this was a Photoshopped version. But this doesn't happen, right? This isn't real. So I like the more creative stuff with Photoshop. And the final part, which I want to leave you guys with, is poses. Most important thing about a model is poses, right? Now there, and people are going to hate me for this. I know for sure. There are many books out there on posing. And if you like those books, buy them. It's okay. For me, the best posing book is the one that isn't written. Because there is no pose. If you shoot me or you shoot somebody else, every pose is different. Some poses work, some poses don't. If you have the perfect pose for me, and you exchange me for that gentleman, it can be the most worst pose ever. So all those books with the perfect pose doesn't work because every model is different. Some models will have an apple shape. Some models will have like a sand loper. Nice.
Hourglass.
Yes, hourglass. Thank you very much, guys. So poses. So let's see where we can do wrong. Pretty nice, right? It's nicely filled out, real lady. Yep. Change it a little bit. Aha. What did I change? She has a big butt here. And this is a little bit less. Now, how did I do that in 10 seconds? Very simple. A camera doesn't see any depth. The only thing a camera sees is something that's closer, it will render it bigger, or something that's further away, and that will render it smaller. So if the camera is there and I put my butt that way, I have a big one. If I put it this way, I have a smaller one. So that's already 5 kilograms gone. Now if you do it like this, she looks very, very tender. But I'm missing one arm, and somehow I also don't like this part. It's very loose. The dress doesn't fit right. While the dress was perfect, it just doesn't fit right. So change one more thing. And I don't know who imagined this one. I think one time at American Top Model they did like, okay, let's do this. We call it the broken back pose. So don't do it like that. But this is actually pretty good. Because now she's slender here. This is nice, but I just don't like the pose. So change one more thing, and there we go, the Dr. Frank diet. In 4 frames, you lost 25 kilograms. Because we went from this one, all the way to this one. It's all in the poses. Coach your model, talk to your model. Don't be quiet, keep talking. Because if you don't talk, she will just crash. Because she doesn't see what you see through the lens.
You set your fees.
My fees?
Yeah.
Okay, if you start out, always double your fees and give them 50% discount. It's very, very simple. Why? You can never charge 100 euros or $100 and then the year later say, now I'm better, or you charge 200. You have to find out, where do I put that price point? I need $100. Okay, then we charge 200 and we give you 50% discount. What a lot of people forget, and this is something I hope they're still recording, because I think this is a great tip. A lot of photographers starting out will drive themselves bankrupt within a year for the very simple reason. They go like, dude, if I shoot a headshot for $75, that's awesome. I have $75. I don't know how it's here with Texas, but in the Netherlands, just to give you an example, we have 21% VAT. 21%, meaning everything I charge, 21% goes straight to the government because that's VAT. If you're in the lowest income scale, we pay 31% income tax. Add it up. 50% of every euro I earn goes to the government. If you see a wedding for 100 euros, what you see, it actually means you're working the whole day for 50 euros. What about your car costs? What about your insurance, your company, your telephone bill, your invoice paper, your software to run your invoice papers on? Everything costs money. Actually, the Creative Cloud from Adobe is cheaper than our bookkeeping program. Because we are being charged, I believe, 60 euros a month just to do bookkeeping. That's the price of the software, bookkeeping online. It's the cheapest option, 60 euros a month. If I only earn 50 euros by a wedding and it cost me 2 days, how can I ever earn that back? So sometimes you see these ridiculous prices of photography. Those prices aren't ridiculous. And that's what you have to educate your clients. In the book, Mastering the Model Shoot, I actually give an example how we quote to a client. We recently got an offer to do a photo shoot for a big magazine. A mail order stuff. And it was 28 dresses, 3 models, 2 locations. And he asked me, what do you charge? And I did want to have the assignment, and I said, 3,500 euros. That's about $4,500. And they said, man, that's expensive. I said, why? Well, we have somebody doing it for 350. I said, that's impossible. And after that, I started doing invoicing in a different way. When I invoice somebody, or sorry, not invoice, give a quote, I will do it like this. Okay, you want 3 models. The model charges this per day, 250, 250, 250. You want a makeup artist, small materials, 75 euros. Makeup artist fee, 250, 250, 250. You want to rent a location, location rent, 200, 200, 200. A small material studio, paper, duct tape, whatever. And there will be accounts like 0.50 cents, 25 cents. Catering per person, 2 euros 50. Behind quotes, we make it ourselves. So also a little joke in there. But then they see all these costs added together. And what I hope is if they're also an entrepreneur, they will see it and they will see the other offer and they will go like 250, 3,500. Hey, wait a minute. 250? Only the location is already 200. Oh. And I hope they will go for me. In the end, I have to be honest, my client also went for the other guy and he said, we'll just try it. If it's nothing, we come to you. The problem is they never came. And why not? Because actually those weekend warriors, those who are your competition, they're pretty good. They're scaringly good. They're probably better than most professional photographers out there. But they will probably only work for a year. Because then they find out, I can make money with this. They will raise their prices and nobody hires them because the next comes. And I think your job as a photographer is to stand out. And it's the same with teaching. I can do the same show over and over again. And it can be successful, but only for 1 or 2 years. If you do a workshop with me, you never know what you're going to get. Every workshop is different. Every seminar is different. I drive people nuts. Organizers, Frank, can you write down what you're going to do? I don't know. Yeah, but can you write down what you're going to do a little bit? I'm going to teach and inspire. Yeah, but what? I don't know. A seminar, this seminar I put in Schiphol, just before the flight. I put the whole seminar together. I took pieces of other seminars and just put it together. Why? Because there are images in there that were shot last week. There are stories in there that were shot last week. Yeah? Oh, one more tip, by the way. I forgot that one. And I want to show you this one. Annevieke, do you have my iPhone there? Oh, sorry. Here I have my iPhone. This one, again, for street photography. And because I didn't do anything with street photography now, I want to give you this one. Did you ever find yourself in a situation where you want to take a shot of somebody, but you're afraid to do it with your iPhone? Watch this. I want to shoot him, but I'm a little bit afraid. So what do? You do it like this, right? But I want to get closer, so what can you do? You can. But at one point, that will be a little bit obvious, right? Would be better if you do it like this, right?
Yeah.
But that doesn't work. Now watch this. Hi, Ma. I call it the inverse selfie. People think you're doing a selfie. You're going like, yeah, it's for my Ma. And he's just going like. So we call it the inverse selfie. It really works. I've tried it out many, many times on airports. And it's awesome. The only thing, make sure your strobe is off. Yeah. I had people standing behind me going like. They'll go like, that's awesome, dude. So I wanted to put that in as a final thing. Any more questions? Yes, the lady.
Which camera do you use most often?
I don't care. I really don't care. The camera doesn't matter. I use myself, if I have controlled light, Mamiya DF Plus with a Credo 60, which I adore, amazing quality. If I don't have control over my light, I use the Sony Alpha 99 or the A7R. Now, if the camera doesn't matter, why do I choose Sony? Very simple, dynamic range. If you look at what Sony is doing now with the sensors, it's sick. They have like this normal camera, the Sony sensor. It's like, I don't know how they did it, because for years, this has been digital, and Sony came on the market, and now digital is like this. It's like amazing what they do. And the cameras, it's the A7R, I fell in love with it. It's very small. People, when you walk up to somebody, they think you're an amateur, because it looks like an amateur camera, and actually it's a 36 megapixel without AA filter. It's the sharpest on the market. And you make this incredible dynamic range shots, and people think you're an amateur. I've been in series where I couldn't shoot, and people with Canons, 7Ds, and Rebels, no, you can't bring your camera. And I was coming with my Sony. Oh, I was going like, dude, really? So I love the Sonys, but that's the only reason. I also love Fuji, but it must fit what I'm shooting. And when I'm doing street photography, the Sonys are great. When I'm doing controlled lighting, I love medium format. But don't ever let your camera hold you back. Many of my students say, I can do the shots you do because my camera's crap. And then we set up the lights and they take the images with their own cameras. And they look at the back of the cameras and they go like, wow. Invest in lighting, learning, workshops, books, Mastering the Model Shoot, very good book. Invest in that kind of stuff. And then as soon as you start feeling, now my camera doesn't do what I want to do, then you invest in your camera. On my website, you will find daily updates, videos, news, etc. I do it every day except on Sunday. So every day I will update the blog with something new, something interesting, I hope. And of course, the book Mastering the Model Shoot. It's a Pearson book, and I think it's pretty nice. So if you want to buy that one, be my guest. Did you like it?
Yes.
Yes.
Ah. Oh, stop. Okay, and again.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.